stung by two swords.
If these geese go on growing up with their human mother goose, identifying with her voice and her red gumboots, there's a good chance that they will sooner or later fly after her, if she moves fast enough, and yield dramatic pictures of flight. At first, she just takes them for walks with her voice, now on a cassette, but soon available on LP and single. And the next step was to put Mrs. Eastman on a bicycle and see if the birds followed her. All this proved, really, was that flying is a much quicker way of travelling than bicycling. So then it was on to the final crucial stage in which Mother is put in a car, sticking out of the top like the Queen, together with a cameraman. There's more to the living planet than just wildlife and exotic locations. There are backroom boys as well. And here in some drenched Boreham wood lives the globe, which featured in every episode of the living planet. But even filming a globe is no picnic. For a start, you have to carry it in without dropping it.
Maggie, is this really the best of all possible worlds? I mean, if you were in a BBC satellite looking down, would the Earth look like this?
No, it wouldn't look like this, because you wouldn't really be able to see very much of the landmass at all. It would be all cloud and sea.
Filming the globe turning is a bit like walking around Britain wearing bedroom slippers. Very slow, very boring. To turn the globe completely once, you have to turn that handle 5,000 times and let the camera click over once with each turn of the handle. In other words, it turns far slower than the real thing. And people wonder why TV programs... Once a roller skating rink and now the habitat of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop. Here they've also been wrestling with the problem of what nature sounds like, or rather should sound like, because much of the time it doesn't make a great deal of noise at all. So they've asked composer Elizabeth Parker to invent enough sound to go with 12 hours of nature. And they keep her locked up in one of these little cells. Liz Parker is what they call an electronic composer. I think this means she has to be plugged in before she can work.
Liz, I find it very hard to believe that in this, what you call a music studio, there's actually enough resources to produce music for 12 programs. I mean, I don't even see a musical instrument lying around. So what have you got here?
Well, my most basic piece of equipment is a synthesizer. And I've got three of those. So they provide the basis for the music. I also have various devices through which I can manipulate sounds off the synthesizer, or natural sounds. For example, the harmonizer is one of them. If we take a simple sound like that sort of sound, if we put it through the harmonizer, which is sometimes called the fairy dust machine, in fact, you'll see why, because it gives quite a pretty effect. It's going a bit high. And then if we add a bit of flutter echo, that's another very simple way of manipulating the sound. I've also got a vocoder, which is something that I can sing into and play at the same time, and the resulting sound is a combination of voice and instrumental sound, which I've used fairly extensively throughout the 12 programs, and a phase shifter, which, if you can imagine the sound as a piece of ribbon, it kind of turns the sound round and makes it move up and down.
No, I can't imagine that.
Then, of course, apart from all that, I have all the natural sounds that I've used very extensively.
The bottles?
Even the bottles, yes. What I do with those is to process them through a computer here. And the computer puts them back onto the synthesizer as a natural sound. If I just call up this particular sound. Let's see it. Well, that's actually got harmonizer on as well. Now that is actually the sound of a bottle, me blowing across a bottle. And you can see it becomes a musical instrument. And one can do the same with the bells, that bell up there. One can do it with scratching mics, paper, glass crashes, anything. So that actually adds enormously to your
brain. So you give the computer one note and it can deduce all the other notes that it can play.
Yeah. In this particular scene, we're going along the ocean bed and looking at these amazing mountains right at the bottom of the ocean. Music is trying to convey that feeling of mysteriousness and beauty and strangeness.
Don't forget, viewers, this is the very same dusty studio floor we were looking at just now. So much for big effects, but what about music for tiny things?
A particular example I can think of was the Leafy Sea Dragon, which I actually used a couple of combs to create a sound on it. It has little fins that waggle around while it's underwater, and although they don't as such make a noise, I created a sound for them using these two combs.
This is a weedy sea dragon. It's beautiful and it's amazing, but you didn't see it in The Living Planet. That's because they already have the even more picturesque Leafy Sea Dragon, and apparently there's only room for one sea dragon in any nature film. And at this point, I'd like to pay my own personal tribute to the things that didn't make the big time. To the Poitou, for example, which showed no desire at all to go into showbiz and looked like Frank Sinatra being asked to smile for the press.